dancing underneath the sun. You're my everything, rolled up into one. You're my only dream, my only real reality. You're my idea of a perfect personality. You're my everything, everything I need. You're the song I sing and the book I read. You're a way beyond belief, and just to make it brief, you're my winter, summer, spring, my everything.
Chimney tops, that's where why? Welcome, welcome everyone. I'm Galina, Harrison Public Library Director, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the library's local author event. Following the trend that encourages communities to shop and eat local, we schedule events where our community can meet local authors and take an opportunity to truly read local. The Harrison Public Library is pleased to partner with Jewish Community Center of Harrison for this author event with Florence Reiss Kraut, who will be launching her debut novel, How to Make a Life. Florence Reiss Kraut is a native New Yorker. She holds a bachelor's degree in English and a master's in social work. She worked for 30 years as a clinician, a family therapist, and the CEO of a family service agency before retiring to write and travel widely. She has published personal essays for the New York Times, and her fiction has appeared in journals including the Evening Street Press, the Westchester Review, and others. She has 3 married children and 9 grandchildren. She lives with her husband in Westchester. And now I would like to ask Rabbi Hammerman to join me in introducing our author. And I have to let Rabbi in because we had technical troubles. We're all learning how to deal with all that new technology for us, but we have a lot of people who sign in. Just need to find Rabbi here. Okay. Still don't see him. Okay, I guess he will join us later. It happens. We will let Rabbi to speak later. Okay, so we will begin our evening. We have our local author and we are absolutely delighted to welcome Florence.
Hi, I'm Nora Stonehill. I'm a member of the JCC of Harrison. So till we hear from Rabbi Hammerman, I just want to say that JCC has very strong connections to the library and we'll be delighted that we're sharing this together. So I want to thank the Harrison Public Library and the Jewish Community Center of Harrison for hosting this wonderful evening to launch the debut novel of my friend and author, Florence Reiss Kraut. Florence, for as long as I've known you, you have been writing. I know you have published essays and short stories, but this is your first novel. As one of your beta readers, I read the first 2 iterations of the novel, and I'm thrilled that my third reading was this actual published book. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and when you started, what started your love of writing?
Yes, I am delighted. From the time that I could read, I was writing. I began scribbling stories in notebooks, and I also would walk down the street and tell myself stories, and I would actually say, as if I was writing a story about myself walking down the street. She's walking down the street and she sees 2 children. She wonders what they're doing. And I would go on like that. I did this until I was a lot older than I like to tell you. In fact, I sometimes still do it. I took English and creative writing in high school and in college. And when I graduated, I began writing very seriously. I spent a lot of my time writing stories and essays. I wrote 2 young adult novels, which unfortunately were not published. I wrote romance stories for love magazines. And I really honed my skill, but I found that it was a very lonely profession. So what I did was I went back to school to get a social work degree and put my writing on pause.
So after you went to social work and the training for your new career, your new profession, were you able to get back to writing? Was that difficult? Were you able to get into the rhythm of writing regularly again?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, I never really stopped writing. I must say, I was writing all through my 30 years as a social worker. I was writing stories and publishing them. I was taking classes. I like to say I almost got an MFA from all the workshops that I took. And I did what one of my teachers used to call writing practice. And that was that I would write almost every day. I would get up very, very early in the morning, like 5 o'clock, and write for an hour. And so that when I actually retired and started spending more time writing, it was not so difficult. And I took some stories and then proceeded to move into writing a novel.
Well, we're all the beneficiaries of that. How to Make a Life has already garnered great reviews. I particularly loved Sue Hampson's review on her blog, Books from Dusk to Dawn. In part, she says, and I quote, "From the very first sentence, everything around me just faded until all that was left was the book in my hand. My top read of the year." And Marcia Temlock wrote in a blurb, "Florence Kraut has written a sensitive and compelling multi-generational novel that begins with tragedy and ends with hope," end quote. How well do you think that describes your work?
I actually think that that is an excellent précis of the novel. It begins with a great tragedy, a trauma for the matriarch, Ida Amdor, and her daughter, Bessie. They live through a pogrom in Ukraine, and they almost their entire family is wiped out in 1905. And they come to America hoping and praying for a good life, as many immigrants did. Bessie gets married and has children, but finds that the trauma and tragedy follow the generations. It's a theme that goes through four generations, because you don't forget the horrible traumas that happen. But they also have choices and ways that they have of interacting with one another that are joyful and loving. And this is a family that cares enormously about each other. The generations live in the tenements of New York. They go through the Depression and World War II. They go through Woodstock. They go travel all over the world in various groups. And they find that they have to do away with or accept each other's differences so that they can have the family that they want. Because if they don't, they are risking cutting ties with that family. And so in the end, it ends with a hope. Not everything is resolved, but it is, it's a hopeful ending. So I think she got it right.
How did you arrive at the title, How to Make a Life?
Well, that's sort of a semi-funny story. When I was growing up, that's what I heard all the time. You have to go and make a life. Make a life. He made a life for himself. So when I was writing the novel, that was absolutely the only title that came to my mind. I kept thinking, how to make a life or to make a life. And when the book was accepted for publication, I was talking to two of the most important men in my life, my husband and my son, and they both said to me, you have to change the title. And I said, why? And they said, it sounds like a how-to book. It's going to wind up in, you know, how to build a house and how to fix your television. So I went back to the publisher and I said to her, I told them what my son and my husband said. And she absolutely disagreed. She said, it's a wonderful title. Keep it. So we put the words a novel after it. That was the quote subtitle. And most people who have heard the title say, wow, what a great title that is. However, When I go on Amazon and I type the name How to Make a Life in the search bar, it sometimes comes up with how to fix your house and how to plumb your bathroom. So I guess we were both right, but I'm happy with the title.
Well, I think that's great because we never know where we can get our new audiences from for reading a book. So,
right. Who knows,
who knows who might be attracted to it because of the how-to. What inspired this particular story?
I grew up in a huge extended family. In fact, when I say to people that I have 27 first cousins and 24 aunts and uncles, they sort of gasp, but it's true. And those 27 first cousins were some of my best friends. We spent weekends together, Sundays. We spent summers together at bungalow colonies. We spent holidays together. And during a lot of those times, I would sit in the kitchen with my mother and her six sisters. There were seven sisters. And they would gossip and they would tell stories of old stories about the family. For instance, they talked to us about my great-grandmother, who was called Kliga Sura, because she was so smart. Kliga means smart. No man would marry her. And they would talk about their friends and their friends' love affairs and divorces. And I sat very, very quiet as a mouse and listened to all the drama and thought about how interesting families were. I think in a way that is one of the reasons that I became a social worker, because of all of the drama and the excitement and interest that I heard about families.
Well, your family seems to have inspired part of the novel. Is it actually about your family or any of the characters, people in your family? Readers are always wondering, is this autobiographical? Can you tell us? Can you share that with us?
Well, certainly I can. I always vowed I would write a book. In fact, I used to say to my family, I'm going to write a book about the family. But I really never meant it because I never wanted to write a tell-all about my family. So I just took the idea of the secrets and the drama and wrote a book about a family. It's not my family, but of course, every author draws on their experiences, and I'm no exception. Some of the characters resemble people that I know. They may be family members, but they're probably friends or acquaintances or people that my friends and acquaintances have told me about. I use, like most authors, I use anything that I hear is fodder for my fiction. So I tried to make the characters very specific. And I think that making specific characters with specific ways of acting makes other people look at them and say, I know somebody like that. So I think that even though they are not based on any particular person, they seem very real. But I did use events and that happened to people. For instance, let me tell you about one of them that is in the story. This family has five children. Four of them are girls, one of them is boy. As a boy. His name is Morris. And he's in the original family, he's the second child, and he becomes a policeman. Now, my family, nobody became a cop. So he is not a member of my family. However, we watch him as he grows to an old man. And in one of the later chapters, when he's in his early 80s, he beats down a mugger who is trying to get money from him with an umbrella. And that was a story that actually happened to my father-in-law. He beat a mugger off with his umbrella. So I used that story to show growth in Morris's character, but it was not something, Morris is not my father-in-law. Morris was a totally different person, but I thought that that was a way to show how he had grown and changed. So I used that event. And there are others in the book that might give you that might have come from something that really happened.
I remember you telling me that story about your father-in-law, so I
right.
know that's an inspiration. I just want to quickly say to all the participants, instead of sending messages on chat, could you please put your questions on the Q&A portion if you have that on your screen, because we will be going back to the Q&A rather than answering the chats. Thank you very much. Do you think that your work as a clinician and family therapist in a family service agency has heightened your sensitivity and insight into the family dynamics that are in your novel, because there's so much emotional items going on in that work? Let's wonder.
Absolutely. Most families have individual people in them who have different issues. For instance, in one family, you will have somebody who has trouble with alcoholism, somebody who has a disability, somebody who has a drug abuse or mental health issues, or is physically ill. All of these special issues make other people in the family really cater to them and take care of them. And it changes the dynamics in a family when people are focused on one of the members. So I wanted to show how one person's special problem colors the way other people act, the siblings, the parents, and the entire family's experience. So I wrote about Ruby, who is the oldest child in the family, and her bouts with mental illness. In the scene that we're going to hear, she is 16 years old, and her grandmother and her mother are just learning or seeing, recognizing that she might have a mental health issue. I'd like to introduce you to Justine Reiss, who is an actor, a voice talent, a voiceover coach, and also my beloved niece who lives on the West Coast. Justine?
Yes, and you helped me with a lot of college papers back
yes.
in the day, Aunt Florence. All right. Bessie often wondered why everyone described Ruby by comparing her to something else. For Bessie, Ruby was sometimes like a firefly, lit up one second, black the next, or a hummingbird dipping here and there, flashing the brilliant red of her hair and the green of her eyes, and then disappearing. Abe said she reminded him of a bumblebee, all gold and black and buzzing around, and occasionally stinging if you got too close and irritated her. Ruby wasn't easy. Bessie knew that for sure. Even when she was little, she was all over the place, never still for a minute. She was willful and determined. She had insisted they call her Ruby, even though Bessie and Abe had named her Rebecca. But it was only lately that Bessie had begun to worry. Just last month, as she and Bubby Ida were peeling potatoes in the kitchen, Ruby had dashed into the room wearing a purple scarf around her head and three lengths of beads around her neck. She danced around her mother and grandmother. "I'm here," she sang. "I came as soon as you called." She grabbed a potato. "Who called you?" "I didn't call you," Bessie said. "Well, I knew you wanted me," Ruby said. "I can read minds." She took a knife from the drawer and started peeling while she pirouetted around the room. "Stop that," Bessie said, grabbing her arm. "You'll cut yourself." "All right, I won't help," Ruby said. She threw the potato and knife into the sink and waltzed out of the room. Bessie gave a little laugh. "She's a gypsy." She glanced quickly at her mother, who sat unmoving at the kitchen table, staring at the potatoes. Bubby Ida didn't look up. Her iron gray hair was pulled into an unruly bun and her square jaw was clenched tight. "I don't like to say," Bubby Ida said at last, starting to peel the potatoes again. "What don't you like to say?" "I worry. She acts like a child. She's wild, like my cousin Peril, the Tyvel. She even looks like her." "She's not crazy like Peril," Bessie whispered. She remembered her well. Even murderous hooligans were afraid of peril. She's just high-spirited, maybe immature. I worry, Bubby Ida said again, louder. You remember that time you found her with the knife that time? Bessie's heart skipped at the memory. Something had frightened Ruby, and Bessie found her standing in a corner holding a knife in front of her, as if warding something off. She didn't protest when Bessie took the knife from her, but said, "Sometimes I have to protect myself." Ruby shook her head. "From what?" Ruby shook her head and walked past her mother. And Bessie thought for the 100th time, why can't she just act normal like everyone else? Then she was ashamed.
Thank you. Nora, unmute.
Wow, that impact of mental illness on a family is all encompassing. And Your story shows the impact.
Yes, and it goes
Ruby's illness on her siblings and even on her children.
Right. It is a lifelong illness. And also we see that the treatment of mental illness changed over the years tremendously, because in the 1930s and 40s, they didn't really have very many ways of helping people who had schizophrenia or you know, different mental illnesses. So we watch that in the as the years go on.
Yeah. Your book covers four generations over the course of a century with a rich cast of characters. Why did you choose to cover such a long arc?
Well, as I said, I wanted to tell the story of a family. And to me, in many ways, the family is the main character in the book. Not that the other characters aren't important, but they are. They are. So I wanted to tell the story of a family over a long period of time, because I wanted to show how family issues go through the generations. And even though the reader gets to explore the lives of the individuals, they see this whole family arc. I wanted to trace the way the actions of a person in one generation impact people in later generations. So for instance, Ruby's behavior and her problems impact the entire family, especially her children. And we see this throughout the book. And other people in the family make choices and decisions that profoundly affect the people in their, the people who come after them. And that was why I wanted to cover such a long period of time. And I called it a saga.
Without giving anything away, do you have a favorite character or favorite parts of the book? Are your favorite characters?
Well, I love all the characters. I think asking an author if she or he has a favorite character is like asking a mother or father, who's your favorite child? You don't really love one of them more than the other. You love parts of them. So I feel the same way about the characters. Some of them, I love their strengths. Some of them, I love their weaknesses and their foibles. I have empathy for all of them. I really do. I would say that I do have more chapters in the book from Jenny's point of view. Jenny is the next to last daughter. And she is the one who works to keep the family together. Everybody always goes to her to solve problems. She brings them together. She tries to help. And I guess most families have somebody like that. And that's Jenny in the book. So she, there are more of the chapters are from her point of view. But I wouldn't say I love her the best. You asked me, was there a part of the book I liked best? I particularly loved writing the stories about the relationships that each of the five children had with their the people that they married. And they're complicated and tangled and sometimes very difficult, but they are love stories nevertheless. So here's one that I think you might like to hear about. In 1941, Ruby becomes engaged to Victor, who's a refugee from Hitler Germany, and he works in her father's hardware store. Her 18-year-old sister, Jenny, has a crush on Victor. And here's a scene that depicts that conflict. Justine, could you read that section?
Yes, I can, Aunt Florence. One Thursday afternoon in late February, when the streets were slushy with snow, Jenny waited at the vestibule of a dress store near her father's shop in Lower Manhattan. She scrunched her toes in her shoes, trying to warm her cold, wet feet. She was wearing stockings and pumps to be fashionable, and now knew how silly that was. She should have worn slacks and socks. Victor would never even notice. At 6 o'clock, her father left the store, and a few minutes later, Victor came out. He was wearing a worn camel coat with the collar turned up against the cold, his hands jammed into his pockets. Taking a deep breath, she stepped in front of him. "Jenny, what are you doing here? Is everything all right?" Her tongue felt thick. She swallowed, nodded. "Yes, of course, but I just wanted to talk to you to make sure you..." She stopped. "Yes, make sure," he prompted. Her heart hammered. "Make sure you knew, understood about Ruby." The words hung between them. He reached out, touched her cheek. His hand was cold. "I do," he whispered. "I know. You are very kind to worry, but you do not need to." "No, really," she rushed in, the words tumbling fast. "Do you know how crazy she is sometimes? How could you know? You haven't seen her. She says she has a Dybbuk. She steals sometimes. She tells lies. You can't trust her. She hears voices and does what they..." "Stop, Jenny," Victor interrupted. "I know." Jenny searched his face. His brown eyes held hers, never wavered. "You don't understand," she said, her voice dull. You can't, or you wouldn't marry her." "Yes, I do understand." "And you'll marry her anyway?" He nodded. "Yes, I told your father I would." Jenny closed her eyes. "Well," she said, "all right then, as long as you know, I've said it." She began to walk away, a sick feeling in the pit of her stomach. "Jenny," Victor called. She turned and waited. "Thank you for worrying about me." He came to her and kissed her cheek. She felt his warm breath, his mouth, the bristles of his mustache. Her heart lurched. She felt a rush of warmth below her belly. She closed her eyes, waited for the nausea to disappear. There was nothing more to do. She had to get away before she cried. There was a black taste in her mouth. Like shame, she thought, "It's over. Forget it now. It's over."
Thank you.
Well, Jenny and Victor are certainly pivotal characters in your story. How to Make a Life as a Saga of a Jewish Family. In what ways do you think it has broad appeal to other audiences?
Well, I feel this is an immigrant family. And I think that the immigrant experience is similar in all cultures. You know, I've heard over the years that Fiddler on the Roof was tremendously popular in Japan and Korea and in Greece. And, you know, it's not just a Jewish story. It was a story of a culture and different generations. In the same way, I feel that How to Make a Life is a story of the American experience for immigrants. The themes of family are present in every culture. Secrets, tragedy, love, betrayal, hardship, economic striving. These are all universal subjects. I worked with an Irish editor who told me she absolutely loved the book and she loved the family because it reminded her of her family. So yes, I think that it is universal and people of different cultures can find ways to connect with this story, even though they're not Jewish.
Well, I was going to ask you what the main themes are, and you sort of mentioned them, unless there's something else you want to elaborate on. They certainly have an appeal, and I think the striving for the American dream, too, comes through. And that's certainly universal for a lot of the immigrants to America.
I think the themes, the universality of the problems that families face, whether it's one person's actions impacting others, somebody dying, and how does that affect you if you lose a parent, losing a fortune, making a fortune. More complicated ones too, like the chronic illness, how it affects parents, siblings, and children. And people sacrifice and give up things in a family. And this is not just Jewish families. All families do this. They choose not to marry somebody that maybe their parents disapprove of, or they pick a career that their parents don't want them to. And families support each other with money, with love. And someone is having trouble, and so they say, come live with me. And then there's the problems of assimilation. If you come from another culture, and how do you assimilate into the American culture? Trauma, loyalty. So most of these themes appear in How to Make a Life.
Readers are always interested in an author's process in the writing of the book. How did you keep your character straight? By the way, I found the inclusion of the family tree very helpful. There are so many.
That is a great question. I did have a little bit of trouble not keeping the character straight, but the timeline. It was really a challenge for me. So I made a map. So I'm going to show it to you. This is a map. Each of the colors is a different generation. And up at the top is the year, and along the side are the characters. So each time I had a chapter, and it took place at a certain time in the history of this 100 years, I had to know how old were the people, how old was this character, how old was that character. It was very complicated. This is an Excel spreadsheet, but I did it so that it would not be complicated for the reader. And I hope it isn't. I hope I was able to keep it clear as I wrote it. I also had to, because we covered so much territory, I used a lot of events that happened in the world. I mean, as I said, I had the Depression, I had World War II, it impacted the people in the family, and Woodstock, the creation of Israel. So I'd like to, Justine, to read another section now. It takes place in 1973. Ruby's son, Joseph, has just graduated from law school, but he's not sure he knows what he wants to do. So instead of going to work, he goes to Israel to visit his cousins who live on a kibbutz. And he's trying to find himself. And he winds up there in 1973, just before and after the Yom Kippur War. Justine is going to read a section that takes place just before the war.
One Saturday in July, he was hiking with David and Shoshana in the hills above the kibbutz when they came upon a boy squatting in the road, his bare feet the color of dust. Joseph, David, and Shoshana spread a cloth under a tree. They had brought bread, large crusty loaves baked fresh that morning in the kibbutz bakery, and white crumbly goat cheese and olives, brown and green and black. The tomatoes were fresh from the kibbutz garden and burst with red juice in Joseph's mouth. There were figs and dates from the kibbutz orchard and huge globes of Jaffa oranges left from last winter's harvest. David peeled one in a long single loop. As they were eating, the boy came closer, standing under the tree, looking with sullen eyes at their picnic. Shoshana offered him bread and cheese. He shook his head. Shoshana had brought a bag of small black and white garonim, sunflower seeds, which both the Israelis and Arabs were fond of. She held out the bag to the boy. He took a handful and began eating them, spitting out the husks on the ground. "Joseph," David said, "look, you can see the kibbutz from here." He pointed to the land below them, green and dense with growth. The boy's eyes narrowed, and he said something in Hebrew. He spit a husk onto the blanket. "Go home," David said. "You're bothering us." "What did he say?" Joseph asked. "He said this was his land." "What does that mean, his land?" "Nothing. He doesn't know what he's talking about." David turned again to the boy. "Go home." "No, let him stay. He's an Israeli Arab, isn't he?" Yes, but it doesn't matter. He should go." "Does he speak English?" Joseph asked. David looked at the boy suspiciously. "Maybe a little." "Where do you live?" Joseph asked. The boy pointed behind them to the village Joseph could barely make out in the hills. The Arab villages were hard to see during the day, built to merge into the rocks. At night, the electric lights of hundreds of them twinkled in the hills. The boy seemed to be waiting for something. "Should I give him some money?" Joseph asked. "No," David said. "You'll make him a beggar." He turned to the boy. "I told you to go." The boy took a few steps backward. He stooped and picked up a rock. David got up and his fists clenched, moved toward the boy, who turned, ran a few yards off, and stood watching them. The lunch was ruined. "Let's go," Shoshana said. They began to pack up. As they left the cool shelter of the tree to move onto the path, they turned their backs on the boy. Then Joseph felt a rock hit his leg and another splatter in the dirt in front of him. David started to run after the boy, but he had already disappeared into the trees. "Shit," he said with disgust, turning back. "Little terrorist."
Thank you, Justine.
You're welcome.
Florence, that certainly captures the complicated relationship of the people involved in the conflict that eventually resulted in the war.
That's right. I should say that didn't happen. That was something I invented, but we did live in Israel at that time. Alan and I and our children lived in Israel in the summer of 1973, through the war, through the winter, and all the next year. So I was very aware of what it was like. And I used that in this chapter.
My next question to you is made up of several different parts. People are usually interested in a writer's process and habits. How and when do you write? Do you write longhand or on the computer? What are your hours that you write? I mean, I know you mentioned you sit down and write a certain time, but then when you were working, I guess writing would take place at another time. Now that you're, quote, retired, perhaps another time. And then the second part of my question is, how has the pandemic affected your writing habits and the release of this novel?
So to the first part of the question, I mostly write on a computer, although I do use notebooks. In fact, I have dozens and dozens of notebooks like this, and because I will sometimes work out parts of the book in little spurts, and this is the way that I do it. So I mostly write on the computer. When I first started writing, I had a babysitter, and I worked in the attic of this house every morning. And I got into a regular routine. But when I became a social worker and I was working and I had a family, I could not really write in the same way. For sometimes I would go for a spurt and wake up at 5 or 6 in the morning and write for an hour. And then when it just got to be too exhausting, I stopped doing that. So my writing was much more erratic during that period, but I continued writing. I belonged to writing groups. which would get me to bring work and show my work to them and read it. And so I wrote throughout the entire time. When I retired, of course, then I had plenty of time to write. And that was when I really seriously wrote pulled most of the novel together. The pandemic has changed everything. It changed the way that I could concentrate, the way that I could work. I remember saying to people, you know, I can't even read. It just in the beginning. So I think that, like a lot of people, I struggled with the pandemic and how it affected me. But to be absolutely honest, the publishing of the book helped me because there was so many things I had to do to get ready for the publication. And I was working very hard on that. So I wasn't creating anything new except social media. That's another story. And what I have found is that because of the pandemic, this wonderful event has happened. I mean, we had almost 300 people who signed up at the library and to attend this event. If I had had a launch in a bookstore or in a library or even at the JCCH, you know, maybe there'd be 40 people. So this has been an incredible opportunity for people to come from all over the country, as I know that they have. I mean, Justine is patching in from San Francisco right now. So that has been a wonderful opportunity, a very, very special opportunity.
I've heard
that. And now now that it's launched, I'm really focused on getting people to know about the book and to invite me to their book clubs and their synagogues and their libraries so that I can talk to them.
Well, I was just going to say that you have questions at the back of the book that are perfect for guiding book club discussions. And you've offered to Zoom with clubs, and you know that I'm a member of decades. If they want to contact you, I think they can email florencekraut@gmail.com. Is that correct?
Yes. Florence Kraut.
And check out your website for
My website. My email is florencekraut@gmail.com.
Right, and your website is www.florencereisskraut.com, correct?
Correct.
Yes, and you can see many other stories and travel essays there. It's really a wonderful site. Justine and I are now ready to go to the Q&A, where we hope you have posted any questions you may have for Florence. So I'm just going to start that. Let's see, we have several. How long did it take you to write this book?
Well, it depends on how I count. the book started with short stories that I wrote about some of the characters. And as I got to, and some of those stories were actually published. As I started thinking about them, I started thinking that they really were a family. And I linked them all together. So my first iteration of the book was linked short stories. And then I realized I really wanted to make it into a novel. And so I rewrote it. I rewrote the whole thing. And in fact, I rewrote it three times. I would say that the process probably took almost 12 years. Often, first-time novelists will say that it took them a very long time from start to finish.
Justine, did you?
Well, I saw somebody asked about the artwork. So many of these questions you kind of have already answered, but someone asked about the artwork for the book cover, and which I just love. And I would love to hear how you chose that. You probably had a lot of different ideas for that.
Well, my publisher asked originally for us to show book covers that we liked. So I picked maybe five or six book covers that really attracted me. All of them had people in them. Then I got about six different iterations of totally different book covers than this. this was one of them. This sort of this, but it only had one figure in it, and I wanted two. So we went back and forth a few times, and I worked with them, and they were absolutely wonderful and came up with this, which I am very pleased with as well.
Lovely.
Yeah.
Someone also asked about an audiobook, and yes, I will be working on the audiobook. I thanks for the compliment, Shelley. And yes, we're really excited to get the audiobook going. And I would say look for that in about a month.
A month? Wow.
Well, I don't know. Maybe that's a little
ambitious, maybe.
Ambitious, yeah. Ambitious, right. We're working on it, though.
Yeah.
What writers influenced you? That seems like a great question. Mm. Somebody has some ideas, but I don't want to tell you what they are. Gabrielle Garcia, Marquez, oh, really? Toni Morrison. What do you think, Aunt Florence?
That's an interesting question. I should have thought about it beforehand because, of course, so many writers influence me. It's usually, you know, writers that I have read recently that I, you know, really love. I adore Alice Hoffman. I love, I'm just, right now, I'm having brain drain. I'll try to answer them later when I can think better.
Okay, I have a question. What advice can you give a lifelong diary writer?
I love that question. Start?
I keep writing, but don't know where to begin to create a book.
Oh, that's very interesting because I didn't say this. I did a lot of journaling over the years. And there is a lot of material in there if you go back and look. Now, if you are wanting to write a memoir, obviously that is the fodder for your memoir. If you're looking to write fiction, then you have to take a step back. And you have to begin to just take an idea, something, an event that happened, and, you know, go from there. Journaling is excellent experience for writing. It teaches you how to write. I had a writing teacher who once said, you have to do writing practice, just like you have to practice the piano. Nobody expects you to play a Chopin etude without practicing it. But people seem to think that, you know, if they want to write, they can just sit down and write. So journaling is fabulous practice for a writer.
She has given me that advice before. somebody really would like to know how to purchase the book. Did we already say, I think we already covered that, but it's
no, I don't think
it's worth mentioning again. How do we purchase the book?
The book is in any indie bookstore. You just can go in and ask for it. Of course, it's on Amazon and Barnes & Noble and all of the major book distributors. You can really get it anywhere. It is an ebook if you like to read on Kindle or any other device. And it will soon be an audiobook. So you can purchase it. However, we do have an indie bookstore, and Galena's going to probably tell you about that.
Yeah, we have signed copies available at the Village Bookstore at Pleasantville, and I have phone number 914-769-8322. And I also put information about this bookstore in the chat. So you can check your chat and all the information will be available, and there are signed copies.
I have a question here from Norma. She wanted to know how many publishers did you have to submit this to before you got
there? I probably was looking for well over a year, maybe 2 years, you know, sending it out mostly to agents and things. It's a very difficult process, publishing. I have a wonderful publisher who I recommend heartily, She Writes Press. They are a what is called a hybrid publisher. They have they've won independent book publisher of the year from the indie book publishers. They're really fantastic to work with, and they work a lot with women. She writes press.
Well, I know this might be tough, Aunt Florence, but a lot of people are asking because they already want more from you. So what do you think your next book might be about?
Okay, so I have two projects that are in my head. One I actually had started working on, might surprise you to know, it's a mystery. I love writing mysteries. So that is one. And the other one is another historical novel. There was an event that really attracted me that I started reading about also several years ago. And so that might sort of jump up. But one of those two is going to become my next project.
So I just want to say, if any viewers' questions were not addressed, or if they want to write and contact you, can you again share your contact information? And I know that we already mentioned the Village Bookstore in Pleasantville and the Arcade Bookstore in Rye and all the indie bookstores. And of course, the big mega bookstores. Can you share your contact information again before we finish?
FlorenceKraut@gmail.com mm-hmm. is my address. My website is FlorenceReissKraut.com. And I have Facebook. A lot of you know that. Facebook, Instagram, and all of the rest.
Well, Florence, thank you for sharing your thoughts and story with us this evening. And I wish you much pleasure and success as you start your virtual book tour. And again, thank you to Harrison Public Library and the JCCH, and to all of you who have participated in this special, very special evening. I see Rabbi Hammerman's on and Galina, so back to Galina and the Rabbi. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Florence. That was a fantastic event. We all enjoy it. I also want to remind everyone, you can get a book, Florence book, from our libraries. Well, unfortunately, it's not available right now at our library. It's so popular, all copies checked out. So you have to put it on hold. But we do have copies.
Yes. And so does the Rye Library. And I'm sure more libraries will be getting them. So,
absolutely. I just wanted to mention that I put Florence contact information in the chat. So it's available there, all the links, how to get in touch with her. Her website. Before I let Rabbi to wrap up our evening, I want to remind you, so many people join us today because of Florence's book, but also they join us because they love reading. Our next big authors event, where we will be featuring 13 best-selling authors, will be all-day event on Saturday, October 24th, and it will be online. You can stay for the whole day. You can pick up historical fiction, fiction, nonfiction. All the information is in the chat I shared with you and also available on our website. I just want to say the center of the community. We love to bring people together. And right now, Florence mentioned how it was difficult during pandemic deal with everyday life. And we need escape. We need to be together. We need some outlet. And the library provides you that outlet. Thank you so much, Florence. That was fantastic.
Thank you, Galina. Thank you.
I want to mention there's a note here that the book is also available at Arcade Bookstore in Rye. We like to support our local bookstores, our small bookstores.
Yeah, and the libraries. Check out.
And the library.
Well, thank you. And I let Rabbi, who finally joined us.
So sorry, Rabbi.
Well, I'm honored to conclude by saying that the Jewish Community Center of Harrison, so proud of our long relationship with the Harrison Public Library. I fondly remember my first year in Harrison when the library was under renovation, and the synagogue was pleased to be a temporary location for the library's children's programming. So each day we saw big crowds of young ones coming through our building as the library continued serving the community during that long construction project. And of course, the library building itself is named to honor the memory of our beloved member, Richard E. Halperin. We hold up his deeply held values through the library's service to the community. But it's not just our synagogue that has a deep connection to what happens in a library. For centuries, the Jewish people as a whole have been known as the people of the book. Why is that? According to Jewish tradition, God is, among other things, a writer, and we should always strive to act in a godly way. The Jewish collection of law, the Talmud, says that God inscribes our names in a book on the Jewish New Year, Rosh Hashanah, which I believe everyone's heard of. So if God is book-focused, then we should all be book-focused. And there's another tradition that teaches that Jews should imagine that all of our deeds, everything we do, is written down in a book. We should always act as if someone's keeping track. And finally, Jews are considered the people of the book because books were all we had for many hundreds of years. Jews were a wandering people with no land of our own, no temple, no government, no monuments. All we had was memory to sustain us and to connect us. And those memories were all stored and safeguarded and passed down in books. Books linked people across space and time, sharing and making holy the very same words through the different circumstances of particular communities. And in that similar way, How to Make a Life, Florence's book that we were so fortunate to preview this evening, not many of us have gotten a copy yet, but I know they're all coming, has taken us through the diverse experiences of one family and shown us how, just pages apart, generations are linked to one another despite the passage of time and a long distance. So Florence, happy birthday, one day late. This is quite a party you threw. Right. We're so proud to call you our own and wish you a big mazel tov on this tremendous accomplishment. What a treat we've all had this evening.
Thank you, Rabbi.
True, what a treat. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Galina. And Rabbi.
You attended our event and I hope to see you again.
You will.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.
So you control us, I guess.
Yes.
Yeah.
Got to do jazz hands, Aunt Florence. It's the best in the boxes. Yeah, there you go.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.